watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
We're back again. I want to pick up from where we left off last time with Mark Francis. Mark, you were talking about people are not inherently bad, and you were invoking something about the Bible.
Yeah, what I was trying to say that, you know, we think that people who have bad fortune or bad situations happen to them, and I was implying that about stories from the Bible, which would be Job. Job was a person who was very favored by God, but he had a lot of bad situations and bad fortune for a while he's being tested. And I don't know what goes on in everyone's life, either being tested or what the cause for, but that doesn't inherently mean that they are bad and or it's some type of punishment or curse because of anything that they have directly done. Some of it is a culmination, and a lot of times it's a culmination, and all the times it is timing. It has a number of things that factor in. I think the most important thing that we, as people who are sometimes in good position or we're having a good way with life or a comfortable way with life, to extend ourselves, to try to help people right their ship and win some of their battles that they're facing, and not to take everything in a literal or give reason for why bad fortune takes place. We don't have reason for why good fortune takes place. We just figure, oh yeah, they earned it. I know some people who worked very hard and done mountains of work and haven't got what someone would believe would always good happen to them.
Yeah, good point.
You know, like someone wakes up one day after being a person who was physically fit in all kind of great condition, and they find out that they have a terminal illness for no reason of their own. But it happens.
What would you say is your most difficult over the course of your life? What's been one of the more difficult obstacles or challenges for you in your life?
My most difficult challenges is trying to figure out what way that I can be used to assist others to be more productive. Like I said, things for me in my life, I think some type of favor has been bestowed upon me. But I think that some of the toughest things is not to just figure out, you know, how I can advance my own flag or something like this. How can I make someone's life stable or just right so they can just get in the game? What? So they can just, you know, try to get the maximum potential out of themselves. But also in that, when I do extend myself in that fashion, my receipt for that is that you're gonna help someone else.
Pay it forward.
Exactly. You have to do that because I have a problem with, you know, trying to help out and then the person's gonna keep what assistance or energy that I, you know, help them with and just keep it all to themselves. It's just not the way that this world exists. We exist by taking care of one another. We exist by making sure that there's something left. For example, we have a lot of talk about, you know, global warming and running out of resources. Because I always feel governments don't make society better. Society is made better one human being at a time. I think when Jesus was creating miracles, you know, he was doing it one soul at a time. He wasn't out there, you know, and he had access to any type of arrangements that he wanted to show his greatness to the world. But it wasn't like that. He was showing people by examples of him to one person, and then that was probably one of your greatest examples of paying it forward. Because the people that he helped became amazed by what he did and also wanted to follow what he did. Now, I'm not saying that to change anybody's religious beliefs. I'm just telling you, for his examples that he set to the world. And there's been other people who have set those same examples. And I think that us as human beings, we have to stop getting caught up on religions and political flags and all of that. And we got to start realizing, how do I make this thing better? Well, we make this thing better by me and you making it better. When we talk about issues of racism, and we talk about issues of injustice, well, we can't stand idly by. If I see certain things and I ignore it, I'm almost a silent supporter. So when we have opportunities to make headway, and I'm not saying to be on a grandstanding soapbox, but we have to understand that, you know, when we don't want a certain way of life to take place or take root, we got to do our little bit and our little part to make sure we extinguish with the things that we know are inherently bad. You know, people who are on an ego trip or whatever, I'm not telling someone to go out there and hate them or be in opposition, because a lot of times that's the easy route to take. What we have to do in a lot of times when we see something, we can't do hate on hate or anger on anger. It don't work. When we have issues as a society, we tend to, what's trending now? Let's talk about it because we're angry. Not a lot get done when we're angry. When we are cool and everything is good, those are the times to talk about problematic situations. Because you know and I know, if me and you are in a heated argument, we're not going to get nothing solved, because we're going to both be going like this. We're not going to get anything solved. Nobody wants to back down. I always told people, hey, you got a significant other or whoever you may be dealing with, if you get into an argument with them, usually not a lot's going to get resolved. But the time to talk about issues or problems is the time when y'all have peace and serenity. And things that were issues, you should probably approach them then, so you can approach them with a problem-solving mindset. And a lot of times people want to point blame and assign responsibility to a lot of the wrongs of the world. But nobody don't want to make a solution, or they don't want to sacrifice to make the solution for it. So that's where a lot of us as human beings trying to make it better come to play. Because we want to put the responsibility on somebody else. We want, oh, the government has to do that. The schools are supposed to do that. Well, I know when I was being taught, you know, as a young person, and even now as the person that I am, there's some people responsible for your teaching, but, you know, some of that responsibility comes in many different droves and from many different areas. As a kid growing up, you were actually part of my upbringing, my rearing. You might not look at it like that, you're like, I'm his teacher, but you were a lot more. And that's what people have to understand. I have to sometimes provide that a little bit more.
What's your proudest achievement?
Proudest achievement? Oh. Being an example for some of the young people who've come from where I've come from, out of similar circumstances, to say there's other things that I can do that are not exactly things that everybody embraces for some strange reason. I don't know why, but do it, be successful, be actually congenial in doing it, and not make it, not leaving a stigma on it that would be ring negative. And you know that I just basically tried to do it the right. I tried to do it as right as I could do it, and you know that example from some people seeing that and actually emulating it and telling me that they appreciated those examples that I set was good. Those are some of the things that I felt good about, but the things that have made me feel even better is that knowing that I did have that impact, because that's where, you know, any wealth that I achieve in this world, that's in my wealth and legacy.
So it's not you're not mentioning that piece of paper with a college degree on it. You're not mentioning the ranks that you achieved. You're not mentioning the athletic stardom that you attained. You're talking more about what you're proudest of is the knowledge that you made a real difference in the lives of other people in a positive way.
Right.
That's what you're saying.
I would have to say, yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. And also the fact that their lives are better. That's the most fulfilling thing that I've gotten out of my life, to know that I've had a hand, because I can't say I made it. That's not right. I didn't make it, because you know what? We work together, but where we collaborate, me and whoever have collaborated to make better situations, for not only for them, but for someone else. Because like I said, if I had any hand in it, my receipt is you got to help somebody else out.
Hey Mark, if you had a do-over, if you were granted a do-over, what would you do differently? If you could go back in your life and have done something in a different way than what you did, what would it be?
Oh, geez. I probably would have, I'm almost at a loss for something like that, because, you know, I'm pretty happy with some of the things I've done. I wish I could have been stronger earlier on and understood things that I've seen now. I guess I wish I could have saw into the future a little bit better, to be a little better equipped to deal with what I was dealing with then. I could have, you know, made some better understanding and reached some people that I probably missed. I think some of the people that I missed early in my life that I think I could have assisted better.
So if you could have seen a little bit, if you had been a little bit maybe wiser, a little bit more forward thinking, a little bit more aware, what would you change?
Actually, what I would have changed that? I would have used the wisdom that I had. Probably
to do what?
To help, to share with people. I didn't
even more than what you did.
Yeah, I think I had certain components of wisdom in me, and I'm not going to talk about academia, because I'm like, you know, how smart do you need to be? I mean, people are pretty simple. We're all pretty simple beings, and I say that because I earmarked that. I'm like, you know why we're pretty simple here in America? We're pretty simple. We had pet rocks. We sold people pet rocks, and somebody made $1 million on that. So I look at it like I'm going like that. So we're pretty simple. So I think that, you know, we all have the answers to a lot of our issues. I think I wish I would have been more patient earlier on when I had an opportunity to make impacts. I wish I would have been a little more vocal and forceful with some of the things that I had and thought. I wish I would have incorporated more buy-in for people who I thought was in opposition. And I think I could have gotten that buy-in had I been more patient.
Well, you're retired now. We're going to wrap this up in a minute. You're retired. I want to just ask you quick. You're a retired lieutenant now.
Yes.
What would you, what do you miss? What about your job do you miss?
Well, I miss the people. I don't miss the hurt factor.
5 minutes? 10 minutes? Okay.
Yeah, I miss the people. I miss some of the opportunities that I had to help. I'm seeking them now. I'm seeking opportunities now, but that's what I miss. I miss some of the opportunities that I had to help people. But I think it kind of ran me down, so I'm recharging. I'm kind of recharging now, but once I get charged back up, I'm gonna find a way.
You miss the people. Is that the people of, the people, the public that you were involved with, and also your fellow colleagues, fellow officers, and you miss all that stuff.
Well, the officers, the community, you know, all of the whole gambit of, you know, what I had to deal with. Because one thing I could say about being the police is it's truly a people job. Because the only place that they don't have police is in the Sierra Desert, because there's no people there. Anywhere you have people, you're going to have police. And that's why, as police, we really have to focus on humans, human beings. We have to focus on the humankind.
Well, what don't you miss? I mean,
what I don't miss?
Toward the end there, you were telling me how you getting a little bit burned out. You became a little bit, I don't know, maybe jaded or cynical about the system.
Well,
what don't you miss?
What don't I miss? I miss some of the changes that were made based on something that wasn't real. You know, like, I think one thing about policing, people is the most important thing. But at some point it started to become about money. And then it started to become about, you know, technology. Well, technology is fine if it's servicing people, but basically, us as police officers, we have to understand we're a microcosm of any community, or every community. We're a microcosm of them. We are the people. And I think that we start to lose sight of that at some point. And I think that some of our training and experience, some of our training went away from people, and it created situations for bad things to happen.
You told me recently, we were having a brief talk the other day, and you said something to the effect about you felt you got to the point where you began to feel like some sort of a tool or a sucker, a tool of the system that was kind of using you as an enforcer to keep order in a tough area, rather than society trying making efforts to so that that environment did not exist,
right?
But that they were perpetuating that environment, and they were just using policemen as enforcers to kind of keep the status quo going without having to change the fundamental problems.
Yeah.
You said you felt kind of like you were being used or something, or?
Yeah, I mean, one thing about policing, they always say, you know, what do the police do? You know, they have to police certain neighborhoods more. Yeah, we over-policed areas which we deemed to be trouble spots, but why are they trouble spots? What is the other end of society doing to lessen these spots as being trouble? Meaning, can we pump some other resources in there other than policing, arresting, and putting in jail?
What does over-policing mean?
Well, over-policing is easy.
Being heavy-handed, you mean, with the people?
Yeah, the system, it displays that. If you look at the makeup of any prison, in America, or if you look at the total prison population of how many people are incarcerated and who they are, they're always going to be the poor and more the have-nots. But why do we have so many have-nots? You know, I mean, do we have more have-nots? I mean, do have-nots inherently do more wrong than anyone else? Or they just the ones that's most targeted or easily available to be incarcerated or have contact with the police?
And this
so
is
why, how does society deal with that? And that's what I felt like sometimes, you know, I'm being used to be the club to keep the people, you know, keep some people down.
Wow.
And, you know, and that's not what I'm here. I'm here to protect all. You know, I'm here, as they say, in justice for all. I want to make sure that we have justice for all. And sometimes I think, you know, that was an easy way out, to just let the police go and deal with it. And on average, more duties have fallen to the police because society has broken down and say, well, we don't know what else to do with this. We're just going to let the police deal with that. And it creates a bad dilemma, because anytime you overwork anything, you're going to get the worst of it. You overwork a car, it doesn't work so well. You overwork the police, they don't work so well. You overwork teachers, they don't work so well. And who suffers the brunt of it? The lower tier of society, or who we view to be the lower tier of society, they get the worst of it.
Yeah.
And you become one of the instruments or vehicles to push them to that, or to deal with them. So that kind of disheartened me, because I've seen a lot of things, and I've heard from a lot of people. And a lot of people that I'm hearing from, they tell you they have a solution, but they don't deliver. And like, as far as politics go, I don't support either party based on just being a party member. I support people who want to do the right things for the right reasons. Like I was saying, I don't give anyone a pass. Just because you are this, you're gonna get a pass with me. I feel like that's how we should conduct ourselves as human beings. I shouldn't look at someone because you are white and give you a pass to whatever, or give you any label. And I feel like if you're black, if you're male, if you're female, if you're whatever you are under the rainbow that we're on this earth under, that you don't give anybody a predetermination. Let them show you who they are. And we have to understand that when we do these type of things, we're gonna fare better. And we gotta understand where we see anyone who may be lacking, it's our responsibility to help them. So those are pretty much my view on some of these issues of things that I didn't like when I was policing, or things I did like when I was policing.
So slowly, gradually over time, you became more and more kind of evident to you, and it kind of got onto your conscience about,
yeah. Yeah, yeah.
You know, what am I really,
there were some things.
Ultimately, whose interests am I really serving here?
Right.
In terms of, you know, being a cop in a in or near an inner city depressed area.
Right. I mean, I'm not here to punish anybody. I always tell people, I said, and I think in most cops' mind, they come into the job with that approach. They don't come in to punish anyone. They don't come in. They come in with like a lot of fresh ideals, a lot of fresh ways that they want to be. But the system creates the opportunity for certain things to take place. And sometimes we want to be able to check the system. And it can be frustrating. But we got to understand sometimes the system starts with us each and individually. You know, how do we make it better?
Hello, Lieutenant, how are you, sir? Good to see you. Good to see you.
How you doing?
Good, man. What time did you see him?
This right here is my sixth grade teacher. They put a story on me, so he wanted to come up and do some stuff up here.
Mark, look over here.
All right. Nice. And these are guys that I worked with.
We worked for you. Yeah, we were sad to see you go. No matter how much time you put in here, it's like, when your time is up and you decide to go, it's like you're gone, man. You're gone. Everybody's always gonna have the stories, but it's the.